Joining me today is a contributor for Canada's National Post, known here on the YouTube as My Name is Josephine. Josephine Mathias, welcome to the Rubin Report.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
So your real name is Josephine.
Yes.
My name is Josephine.
Yes, it is. I know why a lot of people don't believe that. They think it's like an alias. Is it really not that believable?
You say my name is Josephine.
Yeah.
People are always getting punked online.
Mm-hmm.
So
true.
They were curious.
Sorry, I was going to say, I think they assume it's like Bonquisha or something. They're like, Josephine's a really good kid.
All right, well, I'm really super psyched that you're here. We met about a month and a half ago in Toronto after a Jordan Peterson thing. We got to chat a little bit.
Yeah.
And I've been a fan of what you're doing for a while. And I think you're actually one of the few people on the YouTube making some sense.
Whoa, I feel special. Thank you so much.
So let's just do a little bit about your history first, and then we're going to play a clip from one of your videos in case people haven't seen some of your stuff, and then we're going to talk about all sorts of political stuff because you are a true political beast. So you're originally from Nigeria.
Yes.
Lived there for what, 8 or 9 years before you moved to Canada?
Yeah.
So tell me about growing up in Nigeria.
Yeah, I actually don't remember much about growing up in Nigeria, and my parents kind of closed me off to what was really going on. I lived in the gated community. And I immigrated here when I was 9 years old. My dad actually first went to Canada when I was 2. He got here on a work visa, worked his ass off for years, for about 7 years, actually. I didn't even know who my dad was for 7 years. And then when he, you know, got his visa and everything, he brought my family over. And yeah, now I'm in Canada. I'm in a great country.
Yeah. So what did your dad do that he was able to get a visa to go into Canada?
Yeah, my dad was an accountant. And then when he got to Canada, he went back to school and decided to do nursing instead. And my mom's a teacher, so that's what they do.
What does your mom teach?
She taught English in Nigeria, and now she kind of teaches special ed kids and stuff like that. So she still loves teaching. She obviously can't teach, a Nigerian person can't teach English in Canada. but yeah, so she still loves teaching, so I'm glad she still kind of gets to do that. But yeah, so my dad's accountant, my mom's a teacher.
Yeah. Do your parents tell you anything about the political situation or anything at the time when you were growing up, even if you don't have great memories of it?
Not necessarily. My parents were not really that political. I think we became more political when we came to Canada. And I mean, politics in Nigeria is just, it's completely corrupt. There's no such thing as politics. It's all just money. And it's when I came to Canada is when they started to get a little bit more political. And I don't know, I think religion and strict parents kind of create conservatism in a way. So they're very, very conservative. So I grew up around that. But they didn't really name it as conservatism. It was just strict and religious and had all these rules that basically apply to conservatism in the way. Yeah.
Yeah. So then you get to Canada, you're not even 10 years old. Mm-hmm. What was that like to be in a new country?
So weird. I mean, I got here, I think it was 16 degrees outside and I was freezing. So why is it so cold? And there's people wearing t-shirts. I did not understand. I remember like driving from the airport, I think it was Piercing Airport, and we all stopped. I was like, why are we stopping? And they're like, oh, it's a red light. I'm like, what does that mean? Don't you just go? Everyone just figure it out. My dad's like, there's order here. I was like, oh, okay. And snow was the best one. I think I spent like half an hour just like touching it and like, what is this? And my elementary school teachers or middle school teachers had to tell me to get back inside. I'll freeze. But yeah, it was surreal. It was a culture shock.
So it was mostly a weather related, order.
Weather and order. Exactly. It's basically it. Weather and order.
Yeah. So when you say you grew up in like a religious atmosphere, what was that like?
My parents were just super religious, and they hoped I'd be also as religious as them. Unfortunately, I'm not, but I think that kind of comes with age and also living in, I don't know, a different country. Nigeria, it's easier. The majority of people are religious. But yeah, they are still very, very religious.
Is it Catholic? What
religion?
Oh,
no, Protestant.
Protestant.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Yeah. So, okay, so now you're in Canada, you're a kid, you're making a good life for yourself. When did you get interested in politics?
Ooh, I got interested in politics. I'm taking political science. I'm studying political science in school right now. And I was also president of the debate club. I was just interested in like discourse and discussing things. I was interested in people's ideas and different ideas and reasoning, the reason for things. But I also think my political views were really shaped by me immigrating to Canada, and we lived in the inner cities. I'm not sure if you've ever heard of Jaden Finch by any chance.
No, I don't think so.
It's kind of like a south side of Chicago light. Like, it's not, it's obviously not as bad, but it's an inner city, majority black, you know, poor neighborhoods. I lived there for most of my Canadian life, actually. And then from there, I moved to a more higher income neighborhood and having to experience that. So it's really cool kind of seeing like the culture there and then get another culture shock and move somewhere else. So it's like I've experienced, you know, Nigeria and the inner city in Canada, and then a much more, you know, well-off neighborhood. So,
which would you say is the best out of those three?
Nigeria. Yeah. No, the well-off neighborhood. But yeah, living in like the inner cities really it shaped my views, because now when I look back, I was like, oh, that makes sense. You are a product of your environment, and a lot of people that, you know, I think about 2-3 of my friends made it out of there. The majority of them are, you know, pregnant, they're single parents now, they're in the system, and it's unfortunate and weird to see that happen. And my parents being extremely strict, and they gave me a curfew at like 5 p.m. every day. I wasn't allowed to, you know, have boyfriends, which I guess I was young, I probably shouldn't have. But they were really, really strict, and I hated them at that time. And I didn't understand why they didn't want me to go out and play with people. And now I get it, because I would have ended up like a lot of the people that are still there right now.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, moving to like the much better neighborhood, I realized that, wow, there is a difference. There is a cultural difference, I guess.
But, yeah. So when I've watched a ton of your videos, I thought, all right, I sense that she basically is a liberal, yeah, my kind of liberal, but I think you have probably some conservative leanings, perhaps, or at least have an understanding. I think that's what you're laying out here. You have an, yeah, understanding of that line of thinking.
Yeah.
You consider yourself a classical liberal? I don't want to push you, but I'd like to hear you say it. But what do you actually consider your views to be?
Okay. Here, I know everyone says they don't like putting labels, but I absolutely hate labels, because like I have some conservative ideas, I have some liberal ideas, I have some classical liberal ideas, I have some progressive ideas, socialist ideas.
Uh-oh.
All of
Let's
them.
Let's get into all of them. Okay. All right. Yeah.
But I guess I just see look at things from issue to issue. But I am, you know, primarily liberal, but I'm fiscally conservative. So that's, yeah, kind of where I lean, I guess.
Yeah, so the root, I think, of your ideas is sort of individualism.
Yeah, though. For sure, yeah.
Yeah, you wanna throw to a clip?
Yes, let's do it.
All right, let's get people to know you in your natural environment.
West has also been tweeting about the lack of freedom of thought in America, and the backlash about whether blacks can be allowed to be Republicans sure is helping prove his point. But black Americans, contrary to popular belief, can hold widely diverse and opposing opinions on political issues. Maybe Kanye is a Republican. I mean, he's never referred to himself as such, of course, but he said something about Trump that wasn't severely negative, so he's suddenly the black Paul Ryan. But even if he is, so what? In fact, a 2012 study by Vincent Hutchins and Hakeem Jefferson, using data from the American National Election Studies, found that 45% of black Americans identify as conservatives. Despite this, however, the Democratic Party typically receives 85 to 95% of the black American vote. The tendency of black Americans to vote Democrat allows the Dems to believe that they have a strong hold on the black American vote. In fact, back in 2016, when Kanye West announced he would run for president in 2020, the Democratic Party's official Twitter account immediately assumed he meant he'd be running for them, responding, "Welcome to the race, Mr. West. Glad to have you." If only the Dems had run Kanye in 2016. Better candidate than she who shall not be named, to be honest.
All right, so I think I picked that one because I think it's just a great example of what you do. There's, mm-hmm, there's information and facts, and it's, yeah, kind of light too and fun and all that good stuff. Now, first off though, as a black Canadian, yeah, talking about black Americans, that's kind of racist, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, I think I've gotten a lot of comments of people saying like, you don't understand what it's like to be black in America. And it's like, oh my gosh, stop. I can have the same discussion about race relations in America. It's just a little scaled down in the Canadian context. And I think a lot of Canadians try to project, I guess, American issues on Canadians as well. So, but yeah, no, I do get that criticism, which is annoying. We should all be allowed to talk about whatever we want.
Yeah, you are black in America right now.
Yes, I am. I know, it's awful. I mean, I've been gunned down like 10 times. People are yelling the N-word at me. I mean, I feel so unsafe.
Yeah, well, that's why we create a safe space for
yes,
you right
thank
here.
You. Thank you
okay,
for that.
So I want to talk about that video though, because yeah, the numbers that you laid out there, mm, are actually kind of incredible.
Yeah.
And it's something that we obviously have been talking about lately, mm-hmm, related to Kanye and Candace and the rest, mm, of it. But 45% of black Americans consider themselves conservative, mm-hmm, yet at 85 to 95% are voting Democrat. That, mm-hmm, is a massive disconnect. So,
yeah,
so what do you make of that?
Yeah, I think it's just there's an idea that the Democratic Party is the best one for Black Americans. It's the one that's going to help Black Americans. And although they are conservative, and you know, in the true sense of the word, they aren't necessarily Republican. They don't believe in the Republican Party. But it is very interesting. I mean, no one group or identity votes the same way as Black Americans do. So there is some kind of, I guess, story that's being told to them that this is the way to do it. This is the way to go. And I don't think, you know, the Republican Party per se is the way to go. And I don't think the Democratic Party. In fact, I think both parties are just garbage at this point. But I think it's a little odd that the majority, 95%, vote one single way, but yet they're still conservative in a sense. I just think it's a leftover ideas. Like, they just need to kind of start to refigure things out. But first, we probably have to start with, you know, changing up the government and changing up the party systems and try to find who to vote for instead of just picking Democrat or Republican.
Yeah. Do you think this was more of a good sell job by the Democrats or a bad sell job by the Republicans? Because when you look at all this, the cities especially, mm-hmm. where it's the worst mm-hmm. for Black people, they're mm-hmm. always Democrat-run cities for decade after decade after decade, mm-hmm. yet Black people still in extremely high numbers keep mm-hmm. voting Democrats. So that's obviously a great sell job, right?
Yeah.
Like, somebody's doing some serious PR work over
yeah.
there.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And I think it's also the Republicans as well. And I think the Democrats make it feel like the Republicans are against the Black Americans, and the Republicans make it feel like, you know, the Black Americans are against the Republicans. Like, it's just, I think both sides are not necessarily trying to help. They're just trying to pander to their own side. But it is interesting that you've been voting Democrat for so long and things are not getting better. It's like, oh, maybe I should start voting a different way, or maybe I should start criticizing the Democratic Party. I think that's actually the biggest thing, is it's not picking a side. It's criticizing what they're doing wrong. It's criticizing, you know, this didn't work, let's try something else, instead of just saying, we need Democrat, and that's it, this is what's going to happen. But it's clearly not working. Let's try to figure out what policy changes we need, instead of trying to pick, like, you know, Democrat or Republican.
Right.
Sorry, I keep saying that, if Democrat or
no,
Republican.
No, I'm with you. So I know you're not a huge proponent of the sort of Candace Kanye train in general, but the fact that that conversation is happening now, mm-hmm. the fact that you made that video, mm-hmm. you view that all as positive, right?
Oh, yeah, no, for sure. I think Kanye really allowed a lot of people to think for a second and try to, you know, investigate some more information, try to figure out what their real, why they hold certain ideas. I think that was the biggest thing. And it was really exciting to, like, scroll through Facebook and see people that are not normally engaging in politics. Now, actually, that might be scary, because it's like the majority of people are dumb, yeah. that's saying.
Don't know what they're doing, but yeah, I'd rather have them involved
yeah,
in some way.
Exactly, I'd rather have them involved. And the thing is, I think, as much as I dislike Candace politics, I do think that it opened a lot of people's minds, in the sense that it allowed them to investigate more. And that's the most important thing, because if you're just stuck in the echo chamber, Kanye broke that. A lot of people, all they see is, you know, Beyonce and Chrissy Teigen and all these celebrities that are all just talking about the far left, you know, super, I hate saying social justice warrior, but super social justice warrior talking points. So Kanye broke that and showed them the other side. Unfortunately, I think, because Candace is kind of harsh and, you know, I think it's harder for people to connect with her that are already so down the drain of the far left. And mm-hmm. unfortunately, we might have to cuddle them to, you know, come on, come to the other side. It's okay. Let me explain things to you.
So do you view that as just like a personality trait? Because that's what's interesting to me. Like, mm-hmm. people used to say to me all the time, well, when you have Milo on, like, Milo's creating chaos, and out of chaos, hopefully, my feeling was, if I brought Milo on, mm-hmm. that out of the chaos that he creates, that some people would hear some good ideas mm-hmm. in a more calm, relaxed way, and then they'd join me on the adventure that I'm on. And I think there's proof in that pudding.
Yeah.
I think you're kind of a little bit more like me, where I think you see a little bit of the chaos that Candace is creating, mm-hmm. and you want people to understand the ideas behind them.
That's the thing, is that, you know, when Candace says one thing, like stop the victim mentality, for example. I think Black Americans that are stuck in, like, the far left echo chamber just sees it as like, excuse me, like, what are you trying to say, blah, blah, blah. So it's like, they need to, either she explains it further, which obviously she doesn't have to do. I mean, she can do whatever she wants, but I think she needs to break it down a little more, because saying get off the plantation, the victimhood, it's harder for people that all they've ever heard is white privilege, mm-hmm. white people suck, blah, blah, blah. It's harder for them to kind of understand where she's coming from, because if you do break it down, it makes a lot of sense. But if it's just thrown like that, then it's harder for them to figure it out. But they can do the, I keep like pointing here, like the liberals are
These people over here.
So they just need to kind of break it down and figure it out.
Do you think maybe you need both? Like in any movement, like if you just look at the the black rights movement, that Malcolm X was different than Martin Luther King, and even the way comedians talked about things differently, Cosby talked about things differently than Dick Gregory, than Chappelle, than Chris Rock. Like, we just need people. People just get affected by different things.
Yeah, shock value works. I mean, it gets people, it wakes people up. It allows them to kind of, you know, be more aware of what's going on. I do think we need both of them. We need people to say, you know, shut up, you're being annoying. And we also need people to say, here's why you're being annoying. We most certainly need both. But yeah, I think she, what she does is, you know, it's awesome. She has such a great platform. And there are also other people that are doing the same thing, but in a more kind of calmer, I'm not saying she's like crazy or anything, she's a tough girl, and it's a lot of SJWs are snowflakes, so it's
You guys had any interaction?
Not necessarily. I mean, I think I've DM'd her, like we've talked over DMs on Twitter before, and this was after the whole Blair White debate, and I was, that was wow.
Guys.
I was just reaching out to her and asking her, like, hey, what's going on? Like, I don't, because she was, I think, closing everyone off that were criticizing her. And I didn't want to openly criticize her. I wanted to go directly to the source. But we left off on, like, a good note. So,
All right, well, I'll put it out here. Why don't we have a Jay-Z, Kanye moment, and you both can come on the show sometime and talk it out.
Yeah, and you're going to be like, guys, please, guys.
I'm a glutton for punishment.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Exactly.
So when I was doing a little research on you, one of the things that I thought was most interesting is that, so you have a twin sister.
Yeah.
And part of your awakening was related to a paper that she was writing in college, right?
Yeah.
So can you tell me about that? Because it's pretty fascinating.
Oh, yeah, for sure. So my sister is not into politics at all. She is studying marketing. And she decided to take, she goes to Ryerson University, one of the biggest far left universities in Canada. And she took a sociology course. That was her fault. And it was called How Society Works. I think it was the title of the course is what bothered me. Because if the course was feminism studies, if the course was, you know, how women are oppressed, then yes, sure. But this is how society works. And, you know, in their assignment, they had to talk about, you know, some societal issue and discuss it and analyze it or whatever. And she wanted to talk about the wage, or I actually encouraged her. I like, we should talk about the wage gap and, you know, how it's false and, you know, how it's misinterpreted and all that. And
you were setting her up.
I was setting her up a little. I wanted to test it out, but I didn't know it would, the professor would, you know, respond that way. But yeah, I told her to write about the wage gap. So she just sent like a short thesis and said like, here's what I want to talk about. I'm going to use studies, blah, blah, blah. Let me know. And the professor, like her response is a meme. Like, I hope I could, like, you guys can like put it up or something.
Yeah.
It's like, the reality is patriarchy. Do not use business sources. They blame women. And it's like, period. The reality is patriarchy. Do not, they blame women.
Yeah.
And like, you know, the
You got a screenshot on this you can send
us? Oh, yes,
all
for
right,
sure.
All right, we're going to throw it
definitely,
up here
so
people can see this.
I was reading it. I was like, okay, this is fake, right? This is definitely fake. No, she basically shut it down. She said, your premise is completely wrong. And it was one of the most absurd emails ever. And use only feminist sources. And
yeah, that was the line.
And in the assignment details, the list of sources they can't use was dictionary.com, the encyclopedia. You couldn't use the Government of Canada website. You couldn't use Statistics Canada. How does that even make sense? How are you going to explain how society works and the only source you have is feminist studies? And you know, as Peterson has mentioned this so many times, they're not cited. It's just within this little group. These aren't real textbooks. But yeah, it blew my mind. And I was so excited as she said that, because I was like, this is exactly what is wrong.
So, okay, so your sister gets this response.
Yeah.
What was her response? Was she like, oh, look what you did to me?
No, yes, she was upset at me and she thought I was wrong. And I had to sit her down and say, girl, let me explain it to you. Here is what is actually happening. By the end of that conversation, she's like, oh my gosh, every class I go to, I've been lied to. They are lying to me every single day. And it's so messed up. And I think this isn't teaching, this is imposing your political ideas on students. Because if it's teaching, you teach it objectively. You show them the facts and let your students come up with their own conclusions. This is not teaching. She's trying to tell them how to think. And you know, I did some research on her actually, and she's the highest paid woman in her person in her department. She makes more money than the male counterparts. What are you talking about? So I'm sure there's a reason.
I don't think you can cite that in the paper.
Yeah, exactly. But it's like, there's obviously reasons Pittsburgh. She probably works more hours. She's, you know, doing all these other things. And that's how you can explain the wage gap. So it was just interesting to me that why are you doing this? Why are you lying to your students? Or isn't the point of education for you, like, or essays or assignments, like, you're supposed to come to your own conclusions by using facts. We have the facts. What's wrong with it? She just didn't want those facts. It blew my mind, but that was...
Right, well, they're often not for facts.
Yeah.
They're for facts that they like,
yeah.
Not for facts. So what happened with the paper and with your sister?
She's like, okay, this is like too much for me, my sister, and she ended up just doing some other like topic and tried to pander to what the professor wanted to get a good mark. And that is my advice to a lot of students, is like, just suck it up. I mean, if you are already in this class, it's not worth getting a bad mark over. The great thing about it was I got a ton of messages from students from her class.
Yeah.
Started to explain all the other things that this teacher is engaging in and how awful it is. And that made me happy because they said, you know what, next week I'm going to speak up and I'm going to tell her she's wrong. And I was like, yes, yes, but be prepared. Don't just say she's wrong.
So it's interesting. So I talk about this when I do college speeches.
Yeah.
2 years ago or so, I used to say what you said about get the grade, like suck it up and get the grade, mm-hmm. because hopefully, you know, if you want to move to grad school or get a good job after or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I've turned on that. Like,
really?
I really had a 180 on that, because to me, it's like we live in a time where people can be on YouTube and expose these things, mm-hmm. share the emails out on social media, mm-hmm. Periscope while you're in classes, yeah. Your teacher is telling you that you're an evil white racist.
I have so many videos of my teachers just, the worst thing.
So isn't it, but that's been so empowering for you, mm-hmm. so that's why I'm not for telling kids, students, not to do that. But I understand the line of thinking.
Yeah.
And I guess it depends on the person, really.
You can still kind of challenge your professor while he's, you know, just teaching. I meant more for assignments. Like, if the assignment says, explain why women are oppressed, like, just do it. That's it. Like, if you're probably going to fail if you say women are not oppressed. But if the teacher is actually teaching, then yes, please. That is the best time, because you catch them at it. And I love watching them squirm. Yeah. I love watching them just kind of look around. It's like, oh, there's a black woman asking me to tell her why she's oppressed, my white professor. Please tell me what rights you have that I don't have in Toronto, Canada. And it's like, well, you know, there is white privilege. And it's like, oh, my gosh, stop. It's enough.
Do you feel bizarrely empowered because of that now? I mean, someone who's clear on their political thoughts and mm-hmm. You're not a victim nor want to be a victim or anything, or use immigrant status or blah, blah, blah. Mm. Do you feel very empowered? Like, almost like your teachers can't push back on you in a weird way because they're caught in their own guilt cycle?
Yeah, no, for sure. And it's also funny because, I'm an immigrant, I'm black, and I'm a woman. It's like, I just have to be, I guess, Muslim, and then I'm all the oppressions. So it's really difficult for them.
A limp or anything?
I got a limp too. That'd be hilarious. Every oppression there is.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny to see how they can't challenge me, because a lot of their arguments is based on lived experiences. This is what black people face. And I'm talking about the Canadian context. I think Canadian social racial relations is a little bit different in the States than here in the States. Sorry. Me being like a black woman, it's very difficult for them. Like, they can't give me any, they have to give me a legit argument, because the only argument is, well, black people feel that way. I don't. So what is your argument? In a sense, it does kind of make me feel empowered, because it's funny to watch them squirm.
Do you feel that you've had an undue influence, I suspect in a positive way, on some of your classmates? Because I'm imagining they're probably learning as much from you in some ways, not more than they're learning from some of these professors.
Yeah, for sure. It's actually funny. There's some classes I have where a professor will say something absurd, and like, there's a student that I know knows me from YouTube, and he'll look at me, and I'm like, I'm not saying anything, dude. And then they'll raise their hand, and they'll talk, and they'll want me to like chime in. I'm like, I don't want to do this in every class. I'm not going to be challenging my professors. I really like the fact that I've encouraged so many students to, you know, step up and actually speak up and say what they believe in. And it's really interesting. There was a course where one of the textbooks, I forgot, damn it, this is why school sucks, because like, you forget everything literally instantly. But one of the students said how it was problematic. And before, we just kind of brush it off. And then another student rolls their hand and said, why is it problematic? And then looks at me. I was like, oh God. I really like that I've encouraged people to speak up and, you know, state what they believe and do more research and not just listen to everything your professor is saying, not just listen to anything I'm saying, do more research and investigate and try to find, you know, let's get closer to the truth is basically it.
Do you think students want to be smarter than the stuff they're being spoon-fed? Because I definitely do. And when I go to these schools, I see such a thirst for knowledge and honesty and facts and an exhaustion with this nonsense. But if you listen to the way the media talks either about millennials or whatever, it's like they're the spoiled, entitled generation. And I'm not saying that a lot of them aren't, but I genuinely think that most people, especially young people, they want real answers, not just like easy drivel.
No, for sure. And I think a lot of this has to do with the student unions. And again, I'm obviously more familiar with the Canadian context of this. But the, you know, major schools, University of Toronto, York University, and Ryerson University. I go to University of Toronto, run by Black Lives Matter. Ryerson, Black Lives Matter, and feminist. York University, Black Lives Matter. I mean, individuals that are part of the Black Lives Matter original organizations are the president, vice president, and all that of the student union. And I was a president of the debate club for about 3 years, the first 3 years of my schooling. And I was like, you know what would be really exciting? To have a debate on racial issues. I would love to. I don't care if I'm on this side, on the other side. That would be such a good thing. Because all we're ever being fed is race. Every corner, there's some poster about being Black in U of T, which, by the way, people just realized, like, during the Trump election, we've been here for 3 years, no one complained, and all of a sudden Trump is elected, it's hard to be Black, come on. But yeah, I went to go talk to the school presidents, and I said, I would love to have this event, all of that. They shut me down. They said, anyone that goes in the other side, on the opposite side, is, you know, trying to question the humanity of Black people, how dare they try? And I was sitting there like, I will be the one, like, what are you talking about? But yeah, they canceled it and shut it down, which is so sad. I was so excited for that.
So it's interesting. I know you've been pretty critical of Black Lives Matter, and I want to get into that a little bit. But the moment for me that I realized it had morphed into something that I no longer felt was positive, because at the beginning I did think it was basically a positive movement.
Yeah.
Or a grassroots movement that was making some sense and addressing some important issues. Mm-hmm. But the moment I realized that it jumped the shark was in Toronto, actually, at the Toronto Pride Parade, when they stopped the parade. They literally stopped the parade from marching to demand that the organizers of the Gay Pride Parade, another oppressed group, submit to their demands, whatever their demands were, that they were going to focus on these issues. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, what a perfect example of everything that's wrong with identity politics, with the oppression Olympics, the whole thing. And then subsequently, I saw a lot more of that style of thinking happening throughout Black Lives Matter. But was that moment for you, as someone that's from Toronto, we met in Toronto, was that a seminal moment for you?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I absolutely hate Black Lives Matter Toronto. I can't say, you know, much for many of the other Black Lives Matter chapters, but Black Lives Matter Toronto is extremely toxic and divisive. And I think it's mainly because we were getting so much better in terms of racial relations, and people were getting along. And there wasn't really, I mean, I'm speaking for myself, there wasn't really that many racism or racist acts happening. But all of a sudden, they erupt and they say, you know, Black people feel uncomfortable during Pride because of the police. When, again, happens during the Trump presidency. It's like all of a sudden you're starting to feel oppressed. And it blew my mind. Stopping the Pride Parade, I was so confused. They stopped it for like an hour asking for demands that the police be banned. And it's like, being a gay police officer, isn't that an oppression? And then they say, okay, but you can go without your uniform. Are you kidding me? No, that's not the point. The point is there was a stigma against being, you know, a police officer and being gay. How dare you take that away from them? And there were a lot of proposals, by the way, during the Pride Parade, with officers in their uniform. That's beautiful. Like, what are you, you're really gonna try to...
Marriage proposals.
Yes, marriage proposals, And I was like, oh my God, this is such a great thing. But no, now they've actually been banned. They're not coming to the Pride, I think, for the next like 5 years or so. But that actually was not the reason why I started to hate BLM. Do you remember the Jordan Peterson free speech event in Toronto?
I do remember.
Oh, yeah. So he teaches at University of Toronto, my school. And this is actually when I started making videos. It was because during the event, this was his first public event after making the series of videos. And Black Lives Matter was there, you know, just there were two sides, I guess. And I wasn't really picking a side. It was also my very first protest. I was just there to observe. I was very confused as to why people were yelling at each other, what was going on. oh, I should have just gone home.
It's too late now, sister.
And so I you know, I observed the whole thing, and it was pretty peaceful. There, people of color went up there and were saying things like, you know, I don't feel oppressed. This is one of the greatest countries in the world, especially Toronto. Like, this is so diverse. It's everyone loves each other. Everyone's nice to each other. You know, the Black Lives Matter were calling them coons. They're calling them sellouts. They're yelling all these things. And I immediately knew who the aggressors were. I immediately knew which side I did not want to be on. I wasn't picking sides, but I was like, oh God. I stayed till the very end, till the last person left, because this was, again, first protest. I was like excited and talking to everyone. I got home and there were articles that were posted by the school newspaper, by Toronto Star, about, you know, Black people were, you know, called the N-word. They were harassed. Someone brought dogs. I was actually standing next to the person with the dogs. Someone apparently brought dogs to chase off the Black people. Complete lies. And that opened my eyes to the media bias. Mm-hmm. That didn't happen, not even close to being happening. So it blew my mind that they would lie about that. And then I personally messaged the leader of Black Lives Matter and said, I'm disappointed. Girl, I was there. Like, why are you doing this? And then I decided to start making videos because I said, clearly they're getting the wrong information. The school literally thinks Jordan Peterson was this Nazi that came and said, I hate Black people and women and transgenders and all of that. So I just thought, you know what? If no one's gonna do it, I should do it. And then I started making videos, which was weird because I had to go to school the next day and then deal with these people.
Yeah, but you know what? You put your ass on the line and it's paid off. Wait, so did when you DM the Black Lives Matter mm-hmm. president, did she respond to you?
Yeah, she responded to me saying, I'm going to screenshot this to use against you in the future. Why don't you say it to my face? I still have it saved because I'm like, I'm gonna save this for the rest of my life. Yeah, the president, the co-founder of Black Lives Matter Toronto said I should say it to her face and she's gonna use this against me in the future. Meanwhile, all I said was, I was there, this is very inappropriate, why are you telling lies? You're making Black people feel like, you know, this is what actually happened. You're making students feel like, that's why students feel like they're being oppressed, because you're telling them, sorry.
What do you think these people, and mm-hmm. I don't mean just Black Lives Matter in this case, but this type of person at a university, whether it's from gender studies or whatever it is, you know, with all the identity politics stuff, what do you think they actually want in the end? Like, if they were to get what they want, what mm-hmm. is that?
That's what I don't understand, is that they are obviously fakes, because if they truly care about Black liberation, there are policies that you could point to that you can probably fix and help the Black community. And in Canada, one of the things was carding. And that was actually immediately, carding was gone in Toronto, Ontario, I'm not sure either the province or the city. But that's the one thing where I was like, okay, random stops, I think that's something that should be, you know, stopped, and it's done in inner city neighborhoods and blah, blah, blah. Apart from that, it's like, okay, what else do you want? They want Black professors, they want police out of Pride. That's not helping Black people. That's not changing their socioeconomic status. So what is your goal? I really don't understand, because it's, you don't care. I don't want to say, I do care. I don't want to say I have all the solutions, but I can tell you what to do. But they're telling people false solutions. They're telling them that we need all Black professors to teach Black people. But I don't know what their goal is. I don't know if money, I guess. I really don't get it. I don't get it, seriously.